side, because that's the most safe mid laner. So perhaps with Team Spirit being already inside this game, we might see it again. Maybe not ganked as heavily. We are actually in the draft, so we can take a look at what changed in the bans, if the bans are already on the way, that is. Because they're not. So this is a fresh draft for Team Spirit. They're actually thinking quite long about this first ban, as if they're not sure what they're going for anymore.
Yeah, you know, they shouldn't have to think about it too long. Bounty would be a great idea, but hey, you know, take your time, think about it.
Our spirit once
first,
again.
Okay, well, yeah, great.
Remember, they also have first pick, yeah, so they can take it if they want.
They could.
What are we, which team, or which player rather, are we going to see shut down most? Is it going to be Iceberg again on Team Spirit? Is that where the focus of Finem is going to be at?
Every game, even the last game, they focused on him
Yeah, you mentioned that they would do it as well in previous games that you've watched from these two together. So.
I mean, that's actually very reminiscent of what was happening at Starlighter with Vici Gaming Reborn, where teams were just trying to punish Mikasa mid, and the way that they handled it was they either gave him more help or they gave him more survivable heroes. So Wind Ranger is another hero that comes to mind. We'll see if they make either of those adjustments, but that's definitely one way to play it.
All right, well, we're going to get rid of that horrific bounty hunter. Good call there, Mr. Team Spirit, but who's our first pick?
Chen.
It does Let's mean that we go. Have Chen still in the pool, and also Beastmaster was banned out first phase last game, but was not, right now, that is.
Yeah, I think Beastmaster is the pick.
Oh yeah!
I even wrote it down.
As called by two of our wonderful analysts. Look at that, it actually is proof he wrote it down, Beastmaster.
First pick.
Although you did write BM, you know?
Bad manners.
So
bad
manners first pick. That could honestly be anything. All right,
brood
next
mother.
Pick coming
it
up.
It could be a broodmother.
You're completely wrong.
Or, or broodmaster, as apparently some people call it.
Brewmaster.
Broodmaster and brewmaster.
There you go.
Yeah. Two known first picks in the scene.
Yeah. Yeah, very hot and happening right now. At Finem, though, I mean, they have got the Chen player. As I say, Spartan plays a really good Chen. He is really active on that. Yeah. What could make him doubt that would be a good first pick?
I don't think anything makes it a bad first pick here right now.
But why is he not picking it yet?
Maybe he's thinking about the second hero.
Yeah,
you got to take your time, you know? Yeah. It's a reveal, okay? You got to wait for that shock.
They love the IO. Beastmaster helps giving you vision against IO. It's not like a hard counter by any means. So
your roar IO. I was very sad though. Roar arrow IO axes.
Roar,
you got a nil talisman there.
So. Oh boy, the push is on.
Nil talisman. What is it? Necronomicon is what I mean. Never mind. Ah. Then IO is really fast dead.
Oh,
that's what I meant.
I love this. I love this. Oy. I love Enchantress versus Chen games. It's so good.
Yeah.
It's just like my parents fighting for custody.
It's really.
Is that too far?
But see, I feel like with you, it's the opposite of the normal custody fight. It's like, no, you take him.
No,
I don't want him.
I don't want him.
No, I don't want him. I'm looking for a Mirana to just put an arrow through that heart for sure. But anyway,
brutal.
But Enchantress wins that matchup because you take a creep from Chen and you put the duration on it, and when Chen takes it back, the duration is still there.
I love it, dude. I love the kidnapping. You know, when they take one and then they just have it run away. Like, no, my child, please.
Basically, what Enchantress does, he takes his child, puts a disease on it, so it's gonna die regardless in 30 seconds or so. You can have it back whenever you want, but it's gonna die anyway.
Jesus, Shiva, calm down.
So
you're sick. All right, anyway, Death
Prophet.
Works. Talking about ladies and dead children, we got the Death Prophet right here.
Nice segue.
It's true.
Well played.
Got it. All right. See ya, TI6, guys. Coming up next. Now, who are we gonna be banning out here? Is that a brood, you son of a biscuits? Give me one brood game.
Please no.
No, Oracle. Why not? Why is that, analyst?
Pretty good against the Beastmaster Roar.
Against Chen creeps as well. They're locked in place, and perhaps they're setting up for a Darkseer still.
Also, it's one
probably
of
do they
not,
run
though.
Like a, the best do they run like jungle heals. Beastmaster at all?
Yeah,
I mean,
they
already have Enchantress. So
I was gonna say, I don't think they.
You
will.
Could offlane the Ench potentially.
If you ulti Death Prophet when he's low health and all he does is just use Soul Siphon, all of a sudden the Oracle ulti is like,
yeah,
boom,
yeah, that heals insane.
Exactly.
So.
Yeah.
Good.
It's
point
an amazing
there.
Combination.
Mm. All right, no Wisp. Interestingly enough, Adfinum's going to be taking out the Wisp, but they don't really have a Wisp lineup right now, so...
Yeah, this is super heavy push already, and they have Beastmaster, so there's a couple of ways to try and deal with the push strat. One is to get, like, heavy wave clear. H Apparition used to be a great counter. Generally, he gets punished too much by the jungle pressure heroes early game. Or there's just trying to win before the, like, push engine comes online, so... Warcry is pretty good against Death Prophet ult, as well as Witch Doctor ult, so I really like this Fed pick, purely just for the Warcry, more than anything else here.
Surprised no Lycan pick. Like, I think Lycan's probably one of the best counters to Death Prophet in the game. You know, his ulti run at her.
I mean, if they really want to push, there's also Juggernaut out there. Heal overload.
Yeah.
It is in the
probably the worst hero against Fen, like carry wise.
It is the like, in the Madara wheelhouse, but yeah, it's not great against that. Gyro, especially if they want some magic damage.
I like to think of Juggernaut as a forgotten hero in this tournament. He's hardly ever been picked at all, and
we've seen him banned a lot.
Yeah, he's banned okay once in a while. Never hardly picked a Dream League. They don't like him, man. Yeah. He is extinct.
Why not?
I don't know.
So much Sven. Like, honestly, the war cry makes your ulti kind of useless.
Yeah, so maybe we'll see him. We probably won't, though. He is forgotten.
Yeah, this
no
game, more likely, I think, a Gyrocopter, if they want that just...
And for
tanky,
off lane, a Void?
Tanky safe laner that can fight early. Void would be great with Death Prophet Witch Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd find him.
I think Lycan could be good.
Finem.
Finem.
Lycan
Finem?
For the Finems.
You
were smacking me around before the show.
I was not. You have been picking on me all show. I've said Radiant nothing but team. Wonderful things to you. Okay. The Ember Spirit is going to be picked up. I don't like Ember Spirit. I know everybody thinks he's cool. Hey, let's wait the entire game and have him do 3 rapiers and at the end, but he's like, I don't like him. He hardly ever wins.
But that is the only only way we've seen Ember Spirit here. That. Whenever there's an Ember Spirit in the game, we're going to have a 60-minute game, 70-minute game, and we're going to see rapiers, and they're going to fall, and they're going to go to the enemy team, and Sven's going to take them, and they're going
to
win.
Yeah, welcome
that's
every
our
Ember
Spirit
game
ever.
Oh, who was that?
That's
somebody was just screaming. Oh!
Wind Ranger
does not like to be panned. Jesus. Okay, well, the classic counter. I love a disruptor pick against an Ember Spirit. Anytime he tries to run, you just drag him back, ult him, and then he's got nothing to do. So
this is the lineup they picked when they beat Team Spirit like a week ago.
That is correct.
Like pretty much the exact same lineup.
Mm-hmm. So we'll see what their last pick's going to be. Any predictions here, analysts? Void.
The other purple guy.
There's still...
Purple Shred?
It's still a decent one. I mean, what else does Skylark play?
There's still a Bat Rider.
True,
he's not really one of his go-to heroes, though.
Bat Rider against Disruptor is tough.
I would say you would have to avoid the Void or you're going to get destroyed.
Avoid the Void.
The one weakness of this Ad Phantom draft is they do not have any heroes that really give vision. 5 seconds. And they are dire side. Their Roche potential is decent with the Death Prophet. Not spectacular.
Talking about vision. Out of the box. Thanks, Stalker.
Yeah, I was thinking the same
Stalker.
Thing.
Hey.
It's somewhat out of the box. I mean, we saw him yesterday.
It's very good
finals.
Against Disruptor, actually.
Yeah,
because you ulti and you can't really glimpse people.
Oh, I like that.
But they're just doubling down on the five-man team fight.
Yep.
Yeah. They walk at you. What are you going to do?
Anchor Smash is really good against Sven.
Mm-hmm. Why is that?
Just because he's all about the strength, and Anchor Smash is based off of your strength.
Yeah, yeah. Hmm.
Well, your base stat.
Interesting. All right. So last pick here for Team Spirit. They've got some definite work to do. They have a lot of team fight. They got drawn out team fight. Team Spirit's got to do something about that.
They got some team fight.
Yeah, they got some.
They just go for Invoker, right?
So yeah, like a mid semi core of some kind. There's also Queen of Pain. If they want to get an Orchid carrier, would be really good against Ember.
Why did they leave Invoker in the pool?
Worthless hero. I mean, extremely underpowered this patch.
I mean, it is Iceberg's signature hero.
Yeah, it combos really well with Beastmaster as well. You know, you roar someone, easy Sunstrike. Sven, easy Sunstrike.
Yeah, I think it'll be Quap or Invoker, most likely.
They're taking their time thinking about it, though.
But they bent out Windranger, knowing that there was an Invoker in the pool. Would you rather not face Windranger than an Invoker this game?
She's much more reliable lockdown against Ember. Like, if you get the Blink Shackle, that's actually a pretty good way to kill him. So maybe trying to secure the late game a bit more.
Here comes that wild pick I was talking
Invoker
about.
Takes a while to get online, though. I'd be kind of worried. Maybe Quap is a better...
I like Quap. Quap Enchantress is a really strong early pressure lane. And is a natural Orchid carrier, which is just puts tons of... It just makes it hard for Ember, basically. His life is a sad spirit. He fizzles right out.
And in the lane, then? Because how does Death Prophet do against those?
Death Prophet's pretty good against everyone.
Death Prophet doesn't really lose the lane, unless it's a dual lane.
But you want to win
then
the lane, right?
Two soul
we saw the amount of pressure they put on that mid lane previous game. They're going to try to do that again with the Chen. And we know that Spartan is so aggressive with his Chen as well.
That was the most drawn out Invoker pick ever.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, they were probably debating between those two heroes. Both have their pros and cons. This gives them a little more late game than the Queen of Pain. Laning stage is a little bit weaker in terms of the kill potential, unless Enchantress gets ridiculous creeps.
I'm terrified if I'm Invokering in this game, because like I know these guys are going to push every single lane. Yep. I'm going to have no space.
So which box are you going for?
I'm all aboard the Finem hype train. Let's go.
Yep.
Choo-choo.
I'm also still on the Finem, by the way. You can put me down straight away. Thank you. What do you think, LD? This box or that box?
Which box is on which side?
Same side. Right.
I'm staying away from Shane here, so I'm gonna go with Team Spirit. They have the
you
Beastmaster.
You called it first last time.
Yeah. Well, I'm going for the two losses, Shane. You don't even know next level strategies.
What do you think, Slacks?
I said it before the game, the draft before everything.
Yeah.
Team Spirit is about to reveal their grand strat. Oh, yeah. I'm with you, LD. Let's ride this again,
yeah,
baby.
That's what's up. America.
A little bit of an awkward moment there.
No, it's fine. Okay. We fixed it quick.
Shane caught in the middle.
It was a high five and a bump. It was
Well, I wanted the high five, but, you know.
That was a
more powerful.
Guys,
okay, next time we can talk about it before.
We're going to have these guys sort out what they're going to do next. High five or fist bump. We'll tell you after game number two of Ad Finem versus Team Spirit with Odie Pixel and Rascal.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back for game two between Team Spirit and Ad Finem. I'm Odie Pixel. I'm here with Draskill. And this time round, Andy, I've got to say, I'm feeling a little bit more confident for Spirit. They've managed to knock Ad Finem up a bit. I mean, Ad Finem, by all means, still got strong heroes, but it's nothing like the draft from game one. So we're not going to see a repeat.
Yeah, I think it's really important to note that Team Spirit, they're picking the same kind of draft where they still want to fight a lot. Mm-hmm. So they're sticking to what they know best, but they're picking it in a smarter way, which I really like to see. But we're going to go ahead and hop into the game right now as it's finally unpaused. But I do believe that Ad Finem are going to have some pretty terrifying five-man at a fairly early stage in the game. So we're looking to this Enchantress, we're looking to some Sunstrikes to potentially, you know, help win the laning phase for Team Spirit. And, you know, potentially what can the Chen do to mid? Because Invoker is a lot more gankable than a Queen of Pain. But we'll see if they want to do anything a little bit different with the lanes here, as Iceberg is actually heading down towards bottom for the moment, but it could just be for the rune. We'll see. If it's just Iceberg mid, then you can just go around with the Chen, you know, you get a Soul Siphon and a good creep.
Well, what does that mean? Good luck, unhappy face.
That's a good luck, but I'm sad about something.
I'm sad, but you guys, good luck to you guys. I mean, I don't know what's up with that. Maybe he's not happy with the DP pick. He's like, do I really have to play this one, Captain?
It's not the most exciting hero to
play.
Yeah,
it's not. It's like, good luck. I'm about to have an absolutely rubbish time playing this really boring hero. But we'll see it. I'm talking about the opposite of boring heroes. I always want to fly on his disruptor over the ages. This man, he knows exactly what he's doing on this. We can see, we can expect to see some great setups here with the glimpses.
Yeah, I would assume so. Yeah. It's really nice, too, against these kind of push lineups in a way, because even though you're not great at de-pushing, when the push subsides and they start backing up and you get like a Thunderstrike into a glimpse, you get a free pickoff. That's when the hero starts to become really powerful. And we've seen that utility multiple times across many different series here at the Dream League, so I'm looking forward to seeing more of it. But I have to agree with you. I really like Team Spirit's draft this game. The biggest question is, what can we look to expect here from Goblax Enchantress during the laning phase? I think his impact is going to be very important as far as what can Team Spirit get out of their lanes, because when that five-man comes from Ad Finem, it's coming hard. Like, that is like a Tidehunter, Death Prophet, Chen five-man team. Stopping that train is going to be quite a task.
Yeah, it really, really is. And we just know that Finem as a team play the team fights perfectly. As you said, they've got the heroes for it, and we know that as a team, they've got the synergy for it as well, going from what we saw in game one in terms of performance and individual player skill and the way that they work around each other. And bot lane, Skylark, already being got on here by a couple of them. He's got the anchor smash, so Illidan's punches aren't going to do as much, but already just their ass with the Thunderstrike. The Sunstrike as well look quite clipping. Skylark goes to the side and will have that salve to top himself back up, but already we're seeing the aggressive potential here with this Sven and Disruptor combination.
Yeah, that Sunstrike was actually trying to cover like all the options that he had and just unfortunately missed by a tiny bit. I don't know if it would have killed, but they're going to go for a round two here on bottom lane. The body blocks from Illidan. All right, there we go.
Well, yes, round does still have the Storm Hammer. Now comes out the Anchor Smash again. The Sunstrike's off point. One more touch will do it, and they'll get it. Always want to fly, finds it there. I think maybe the I don't know if Sunstrike actual vision helped him get that.
No. That Sunstrike was way off. Illidan was just walking next to him without auto attacking to make sure that he stayed in vision for always want
to
fly to get another auto attack.
But I mean, already this is a tough lane to start off here for the Tide. He's got to be very careful that he doesn't fall behind. He's about to touch onto level two.
Yep. Once he gets to like 2 and 3, it's going to be a little bit harder to kill him, but at the same time, I really like that they go all in on killing Tide at the level 1, because once he starts getting extra points in a Kraken, it's like a free Stout Shield on steroids, more or less, once you get to that 3 points, so.
Yeah, I mean, unless, a rotation from Goldblatt, maybe they can still do it, get a kill onto the Tide, but as you said, there's a couple of the disruption and the spend, it's going to be a hell of a lot harder. Elsewhere, I mean, Ember Spirit, top lane, he is having a great time. Already we can see Beastmaster just Iron-Talon-ing himself on that side camp. They did manage to get the early D-ward as well. We did see Abfinim look to block that at the start, but it was D-warded very, very early on from the side of Team Spirit. But of course, this is just going to mean that Ember Spirit is going to get absolute free farm on this top lane, and that's perfect for an Ember. That's going to mean that he is going to get really good timing on the expected bots. And off the back of that, going across the map, he does still have to be careful, I guess. With a disruptor in play, there are ways for Team Spirit to kill the Ember. But other than that, I mean, Enchantress, the Sven, in terms of catch potential, it's not really there. Even the Invoker, you should be able to remnant away from these heroes.
Yeah, it's not too hard, actually, to stay safe until the Beastmaster really gets a blink. That's going to be the point in which, you know, smoke into roar can be an insta-kill, especially if the Beastmaster has book going. But that's not for quite a while. So like you were saying, there's ample time for him to stay safe. Iceberg here, baiting it out.
And you go back to come in, and with the cold snap onto Thug, it is nicely done. And it was exactly that, as you said. Iceberg looked to be in a really bad position, but it was all calculated because he knew he had the entry around the corner. And that's going to set up a second kill for Spirit. So already good start in terms of the action. Spawn is hanging around here. We'll see if he's going to try and make a move to try and find something in return. And Skylark, level 3 now, as he backs off to clear this camp. And I think, as you were talking about the Ember Spirit and the ways that they can catch him out, is this a game where we can expect the Ember to be picking up a Lincoln Sphere, or does that already help you too much against this lineup as a whole?
I think it depends on the item timings that he has. Like, okay. If he's farming super well, and he has, like, bots, Battle Fury, Blink at, like, minute 20, 25, then I think Lincoln's is not a terrible choice for him.
Better than a BKB here?
I think it's better than BKB. Because the thing is, it blocks a lot of high priority spells. So even just blocking a Thunderstrike is good, because that way you're never going to get glimpsed if you can just walk away or Sleight of Fist or Remnant back. You know what I mean? So it's blocking like the initiation spell, or it's blocking like at worst an Enchant or a Cold Snap, which are still pretty useful spells to block. So I think it's not a bad pickup per se. Just depends on how fast he's farming and the state of the game.
I mean, if anything's to be said from the beginning of this first 4 minutes with 30 CS, it certainly could be a very, very nice game for the Ember in terms of the farm that he'll get. I think Team Spirit, we're looking for some kind of action there. Goblack did have the DD coming up to the high ground, but Chen watching him, making sure he backs off. And the mid lane matchup at the moment, 16 for 9, 13 for 4. Iceberg certainly having an easier time this game as opposed to against Thug's Quap in game 1, but Thug still with a slight edge on the Death Prophet, which I guess at the earlier levels that could be expected.
Yeah, I think it also has a lot to do with the fact that, you know, Death Prophet's obviously just a super strong laner with Spirit Siphon, and there has been some prioritization.
Oh, Skylark. He's coming in here. He's heading straight for the Disruptor. He does have this rotation from Spartan, and they might find always want to fly Skylark. He's going to be fine, in fact, with MNT coming in, Paralyzing Cask and Maledict onto Illidan, forcing him back. So they will get the kill on the Disruptor, and mid lane, Team Spirit, they see the fact that Abfinim throw both the Chem rotation and the Witch Doctor down bottom. Go Black, he avoids trying to counter that, looks for the bigger priority kill there on the mid lane, and they get it. So Death Prophet for a Disruptor. Team Spirit kind of out mind gaming Abfinim there with the movements from the supports.
Now, Goblack has been on point with his rotations as well. Like, killing the Death Prophet in the early game, we've talked about this a lot, and I'm pretty sure even during other tournaments people bring this up, but Death Prophet's one of those heroes where if you die a couple of times during the early game, it's so hard to come back on that hero. You kind of have to start 5-manning as soon as your Exorcism is available, and you need to be tanky. Thankfully, he does have a Chen, who's eventually going to have Mech, and he's going to have Ravage to back it up, so it's not like the worst-case scenario, but you definitely want to start thinking about protecting this Death Prophet, because Thug cannot afford to die that many more times.
I mean, you said it earlier, just the draft of Abfinim, they are going to be one of going for these full-on pushes. I mean, at what point of the game does that happen? Is it dependent on a certain eye pickup? And, well, actually, we're talking about MNT. He's in trouble here as they move in. He's pulling, though. Actually, grabs the bounty rune. Still goes down. Skylark's coming. A bit of a counter rotation. Goblack healing himself up on the high ground. They'll just clear out some of the creeps here that have been thrown into the battlefield in the river. But yeah, timing for Finem. I mean, already it's 4-1 favoring Spirit, but the farm's still going pretty good for the side. What are they waiting for the full 5 man?
I mean, they need Death Prophet to hit like level 9, I think, because most Death Prophets don't skill Exorcism nowadays until level 9. Sometimes you see it a bit earlier, but it's fairly uncommon. And then obviously you're going to want Tide Ravage. That's pretty much it, and Chen Heal, I suppose. So once you get your 6s on the Chen and the Tide, Thug is going to need around level 9, which usually is kind of the same timing, depending on how the early game's going, but Thug has been pressured quite a bit, so he's a little bit behind in the experience department. Not by a huge margin, like a couple of minutes, and he'll be just fine, but for now, it's Team Spirit controlling the early game momentum. They got a good tempo control right now, as to be expected with the Enchantress and whatnot, and I think Goblack's rotations have just been a little bit more successful than what Spartan has been able to accomplish. But at the same time, the way that Finem's lineup works is once they hit 6, they just death ball. So it, like, getting a gank here and there for Spartan is going to be great, but it's not 100% needed. He just needs to make sure that he has his mech. Maybe he goes arcanes as well, and then they just start mowing down some buildings.
Yeah, I mean, one of the pluses, of course, is going to be kind of the interaction between the Sven and the Ember. I guess in one sense, you know, Sven's going to have a hard time killing the Ember unless you've got the control. But at the same time, when Team Spirit do turn up to these engagements, Warcry, pretty good against the old Sleight of Fist.
Yeah, but the thing about Ember early is that he's actually not a physical damage dealer. He's completely reliant on Flame Guard and Searing Chains. So when he walks into a team fight, he's not looking to auto attack. He just wants to, like, stand next to you, use the Searing Chains, lock you down, maybe set up for a Tide Ravage or a Witch Doctor ultimate or something like that, and then he remnants back if he ever gets put in any immediate danger. So the way that Madara plays this isn't really frontline, it's more just, I have my frontline with a Tidehunter, a Chen, or a Chen army, and, you know, my Death Prophet. I don't need to take the hits, I can just, you know, play on the periphery, Sleight of Fist in, set up for kills.
I mean, Madara on this top lane, he needs to be slightly careful, surely, because a Roar into Sunstrike could do a lot of damage to the Ember at this point.
He only has level 1 axes, though. Like, if Flame Guard's up, he actually can't go on him. Flame Guard's down, though, you are on point. He definitely can die.
He does need to be a little bit aware of the Beastmaster, looking to make that jump. I mean, you see Beastmaster coming forward a bit.
Actually, yeah, if they Roar Axe Sunstrike right now, he would die, yeah. But it's very close, and you kind of have to assume that the support's not going to be in position, because until just now he didn't have his Hawk out, so now with that he'll be able to see if he's available to get a kill. But
I mean, funny at the moment, he has got 1800 gold. I do assume he's still going to go for the Necro, but before the Blink, because any reason why he would get the Blink first this game. And well, they're going to use the Raw Sunstrike to find someone else. The MNT comes a little bit too close for comfort. They do get the kill. Bottom lane, Thug is going to get brought back there by the Glimpse, but Skylark comes in with the Ravage onto two. Always want to fly. He's going to get taken down. Illidan will get the TP out. So it is a Ravage committed there for that Disruptor kill. Off the back of that, they'll look to start to push, and here we're going to start to see the momentum of Finem with four heroes committing to this bottom lane push, and Midas the option here for this go back Enchantress.
Yeah, that's good, actually. I like Midas on Ench in this game. Good for the Chen army and whatnot. You just get rid of some of the creeps. And the other thing, too, is you're not really going to find an item on Enchantress that's going to have a gigantic impact as a first item. Like, typically you see Dragon Lance, you know, or Treads and a Stick.
Drums.
So, yeah, it's nothing, like, huge that he's going to be able to get that's just going to turn the game around in one item. So if they want to play it a little bit greedier, wait it out. You know, even the attack speed still helps Enchantress anyway, because most of the time you're sitting in the back just auto-attacking people. So for that hero, I think it's perfectly okay to go for a Midas in this position. They do lose their safe lane tier 1, though. And I like the movement from the Ember. He's just realizing that he needs to play as kind of a space creator in this game.
And he might even find himself a kill with this positioning. He comes forward. There will be a glimpse back, but straight away with the Remnant to counter it. Madara moves back into position and takes himself a kill. And as you said, the activity from this Ember certainly paying off as he's top of the board in terms of net worth. 4.8k at the moment on the Ember Spirit. And it may look to rise even more if Finem commit for this second tier 2.
Yeah, they're being very patient with their ultimates as well. They're not committing Exorcism to this tower. To be honest, this has high ground potential. Like, look at how many skeletons they freaking have, man. This is insane.
This is
actually a high ground potential push.
How much damage you got in each of those? 24! Hey, yeah. It's not bad.
I mean, they're no Treants, but they'll do.
They're
not going to go for the full commitment. They just want to maybe protect their tier 1 or just go for the tier 1 mid themselves.
Let's see how much of a wrap round they can get. That's the bot's turn for the Amber Spirit, Iceberg. Still positioned fairly deep into enemy territory, and they can find this wraparound hit. He's already going to start heading up the river. It looks like that'll be enough for him to get away. The bird hill flap is lost.
It's getting a little bit sketchy though for Spirit, because right now they do have all of their ultimates available, but they don't really want to fight into the five man of Ad Finem. It's terrifying.
I mean, yeah, Exorcism's there. You can have Ravage back up again in a bit and Goblack out of position.
That's a really bad pick, actually. They needed all their heroes up and available to fight if they were going to go on this, but they are going to be trading a safe lane tier 2 while the mid tier 1 falls in their favor. And they're just keeping the train rolling, man. Still have not popped Exorcism either.
This is really, really impressive.
Thug even has an Invis as well, which is like one of the best runes for Death Prophet. Okay, he just pops it randomly, of course.
I might have timed out though. Oh.
Yeah, no, actually you're right, because it's almost 12 minutes, because it's every 2 minutes. So yeah, I might have just timed out. Or they could have just popped it to go to the Roche Pit, which we'll see in a second.
I'm just going
to
smoke it, so they're doubling back. See what they can do. Top tower is under attack. Always want to fly an Iceberg of the two towards the mid. No, it's not going to be the ace. I mean, Chen, as we can see here. Axe Rush. Why not? 700 gold away from having it done.
I mean, you got a Tidehunter. He's not going to go blink. He's just going to go mech.
And once you've got the Ancients involved in this push, you're going to have that by 15 minutes at this rate. I mean, how do you stop that Team Spirit? It's going to be so hard. Again, Ad Finem. They've really been pulling out some impressive stuff this Dream League, and today is no exception. Game 1 was going their way, and Game 2 now, they're really starting to find their footing, and they've got to do something big to come back into this one Spirit. The sentry's dropped, and again, another kill for the side of Ad Finem, and that's an Iceberg. Iceberg Invoker gone. Bottom lane, Funnik will be able to find himself a tier 1. He's continued to rack up that gold on top of the level 1 Necro.
He's actually got so much money. He is rich right now. This is the guy I'm looking to kind of pull this back. You know, you get a good roar, you mana drain the tide maybe when they're pushing high ground for no Ravage, and they can win a high ground fight, but Ad Finem playing the long game, they're just going to go for Roshan. Just making... Oh, roar. Madara's in trouble.
Got the Hand of God. Been chased down. He's out of mana, but Amity's there with a backup. So, Madara is going to be fine in this situation, but it was a close one.
Just imagine if Iceberg was actually alive.
That was the thing, really. That was what they were missing there. Yeah, one Sunstrike and that would have done the job. Actually not going to be able to finish off this rush by the looks of it, even though they commit Exorcism for it. They actually opt to back off and just play it safe. A little bit wary that Team Spirit are back up in full force. I think, as you said, the fact that the Beastmaster Funnik is doing well in terms of gold, and of course, both the Invoker and the Ench, as the game goes on with their Midases, they're really going to come into it. So, as long as they can kind of hold off and not to lose too much off the back of these early pushes that are being attempted by Ad Finem, things could start to look up for Team Spirit.
Oh, absolutely. Like one or two good high ground defense, and even getting this pick here onto Spartan is going to help tremendously.
Glimpse back. As Team Spirit were able to close in with that smoke, and they might even have a shot at finishing off Roshan here. It's at half health. They're moving forward. Ad Finem still want to fight. They do have everything apart from the Exorcism up.
Oh, they can't fight without that. That
so
is actually
Ravage and Deathward
really
are there, but it's not enough. They'll get it. Iceberg grabs himself the Aegis, and Team Spirit take Roshan.
That's a huge momentum swing, honestly, for Spirit. Like, they use the Exorcism in the pit to try to kill Roshan. Don't kill it back. Then Spartan gets picked, and then they lose Roshan. A really bad turn of events here for Ad Finem. And the problem is, their team, unlike a lot of the drafts that we've seen so far from here at Dream League, is that they don't have the vision hero this game. So they're not going to be able to just choke out Team Spirit once they have an advantage. We've seen it time and time again. They get a Batrider, they get a Beastmaster, they get a Bounty. And even if they can't high ground, they constrict the map. That's what they do with their vision. But they don't actually have that hero. They just have a full-on push, I want to try to go high ground by like 20-25 minutes and end the game kind of strategy. So those lineups aren't as good at maintaining control over the map because they do lack the vision control. Whereas Team Spirit, they have a Beastmaster. They can split push.
Amadara, a great setup from Funnik. Raw, Sunstrike, Illidan as well. And this now, off the back of that, I think Funnik's pretty much got the gold here for level 3 Necro. Next time, he won't even need the Sven to do that. Raw, level 3 Necros and a Sunstrike, you're getting the kill on Tamba every time at this point of the game.
Now, Team Spirit have played this very well, just always making sure they're farming on somebody. Whenever the 5-man is going around the map, Skylark just getting forced back here, all his mana being drained by the Necro Book. And this stuff is so annoying as a Tidehunter.
Get that mana back, man. That was a very, very good juke there from Skylark. That almost certainly would have killed him.
The Tide did go blink. I really thought he would just go mech. I suppose
that's
one of those.
Interesting one, yeah. With the axe rush.
If you think of it this way, the mech is good when you're pushing high ground, but the mech is not as good when you're defending your own base because you want to try to get a better rabbit.
Okay. So you think the initial attention could have been indeed to get the mech, but the way that the game's panned out, he's reassessing the situation.
Yeah, I think he changed his mind. Because think of it this way, if the Death Prophet's hitting a tier 3 tower and you're standing behind her, you don't need a blink because the threat is your tower is just going to die. But if the enemy team is hitting your base and you're sitting back there with the mech, you can't get in. You can't just walk into a God Strength Sven, a Static Storm, and a Beastmaster. You're going to get wrecked.
Yeah, I mean, you're either going to get wrecked or you're going to get glimpsed back out.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a good change-up. Adaptation is necessary in games like this. They are definitely on the back foot, though. No question about that.
So they can find something big hit. They're smoked up. This is going to be the Blink Dagger reveal. They're going to look for a jump. Sidelines. Manor's actually being caught out in the Static Storm as well. The Sundra, they'll get it. The Roar to seal the deal. They will find it. Mid lane, and Finem started to move in, but of course Team Spirit backed off to make sure that the Ember kill was a successful one, and Ember down 40 seconds. Team Spirit, it looks like they have dealt with very nicely with that initial trouble that Finem were going to be bringing them with that five-man push, and now Team Spirit are hitting back as hard, and if not even harder, as they're now knocking onto the tier 3s.
They just had that really nice timing between the Exorcism of Thug, getting that Roshan, taking it away from Ad Finem is even the bigger point. Because if they get that Roshan, for example, they maintain map control for the next, 10 minutes, give or take. Or at least, 8 or 9, whatever the minimum respawn time is for Roshan. And that means that they're farming that whole time, Team Spirit aren't pressuring the map, and they can just get one extra item. You know, they finish that Aghanim's on Spartan, which he did get it, but it's a little bit later than he would have liked it to have been. And there's still a Tier 1 in the offlane and a Tier 2 mid. They are very far away from their timing in regards to when they're supposed to be going high ground.
I can see down at bottom, Madara just changing up Illidan, and it's a smart TP out as well. The rest of our Finem were closing in on that bottom river and gets himself out to safety.
I mean, Funix got his book 2 and a blink. He's 70 gold away from having the book 3, or even less actually.
I mean, 18 minutes in as well, that is incredibly impressive.
Well, their goal in this game wasn't to try to shut down the Beastmaster, it was to try to push and win.
I mean, Funnit was that was the thing. Every time Alpin were going for a push as 5, Funnit was going for a push as 1.
Right. And then that's just the strength of the Beastmaster as well, because once you get the maxed out aura and you have 4 as Iron Talon,
Funnit, talking about the man, jumps in, Roar onto Spartan. I quite tried to finish him up, but now Spartan is going to be able to survive through the initial initiation from Spirit, and it's actually Alpin just making sure that Spirit don't hang around anymore. Nice, but backs off. And that roar there from Funnic won't be able to find anything, but at the same time, they don't lose anything in return. And that is your level 3 Necro now picked up, as we were just talking about, from Funnic. 9-6 at the moment, 18, coming up to 19 minutes in. The net worth looking very good for the cause of the side of Team Spirit, but Ad Finem, as always, they do still have that threat of a really nice full 5-man. And of course, as we were talking about, with that blink on the Tidehunter, just finding a huge ravage, allowing the Death Prophet to get into position, getting out a multi-hero silence, and then the Death Ward as well. They've still got the potential to wipe Spirit if they're out of position in these team fights. But so far, Team Spirit, they've just been playing really smart in terms of positioning.
Yeah, and the nice thing too is Spirit can play the slow game. You know, late game Sven, Invoker, Beastmaster, or on top
and
of that.
And with those minuses.
You're going to have great late game. You're going to have this kind of vision control too with the Beastmaster that we talked about Ad Finem don't have access to. So they're not going to be able to play that game, Ad Finem, I really feel like they need at least one of those heroes because they play so well around it. I feel like this is something that's actually a bit unconventional for them to like go for the full 5-man push instead of just saying, okay, we'll get one hero at least, a Night Stalker, a Bounty, a Bat, anything.
Yeah.
But they don't actually have a single one, which I find a little bit uncommon for them. But maybe they had a plan like this going into it. They still played it fairly well. It's just, I think between Team Spirit, Galblack's rotations early were really solid, and they stopped Roshan, got it for themselves. That was like the huge turning point, absolutely. Like, if Team Spirit didn't get that Rosh, I'd say this game could have been almost over already in favor of Ad Finem. Like, that's how big of a difference that kind of thing makes.
Yeah, especially at that time of the game.
Yeah.
If they managed to get Rosh. And I think, going back to Goldblack as well, on this end, she's had a much better game than as we saw on the Treant. Even though Treant is kind of, that's his hero. That's the hero that goes. Yeah. He loves to pick it, he loves to draft it, he loves to play it. But on the end, he was just able to get so much more done this game. And I think it just goes back to the fact that in the draft, they kind of look. We're like, game one, we kind of messed up the drafting phase. We let Ad Finem have exactly what they want, and they managed to force Ad Finem into a little bit more of a corner. Ad Finem still coming up with a lineup that obviously had good intentions and had a plan early on, and by all means still does have potential at this point. But Team Spirit, they certainly just seem to be using their tools a lot better in game two and able to deal with what Finem have just that little bit more easier than in game one, as we've seen so far.
If they can continue that here, some warding being done here by maybe next time. I do think that there are a couple of ways that Finem can actually make their way back into the game. But if Team Spirit play like the War of Attrition and just choke you out, use Beastmaster Vision, place Hawks everywhere, and just constrict you, it's a very tough game to play out.
Oh. Phonic. He's very close to a hell of a lot of them here. And that crow. You know, it's just holding the back, and Scarlet's going to look to try. Trying to find that up there. Thug, nicely done there. Takes the gold and yules himself to duke out the deeps and little iceberg trying to turn around onto Madara as Madara jumps in onto him. Madara's got the backup of MNT and he'll drop down the death ward, but which is going to be glimpsed back there by Always Wanna Fly, cancelling the death ward, and no kill's going to be found for the time being. Skylark jumps forward here, Always Wanna Fly. Is he going to ravage for this? He's not. Not worth it, he decides at the end of the day.
I think ravaging actually is worth it though.
You reckon at this point when you're behind?
Yeah, I think with this type of team, especially since the tier 1's like right there. I mean, I think you ravage for that because you know that Iceberg is already gone anyway, and there's probably not going to be a team fight because he TP's out. So, you know, you still have Exorcism to fall back on as well. There's no Aegis because you know that it was gone after you went on the Invoker anyway. I think it's one of those things where you can't really justify using it on a support, but at the same time, with this type of lineup, when you're behind, I feel like you need to just, like, kitchen sink everyone, you know what I mean? Just going like, oh, you're dead, pop all our ultis, kill you. Because the kills are just that much more valuable for getting the map control back.
Oh, Skylark jumps in, Always Wanna Fly is gonna glimpse him back here, but this time Madara gets tag teamed in, but Always Wanna Fly lays down the statics on the kinetic field as well. This man's play on the disruptor. It's very, very flashy. He may still be in trouble in years. Madara will come forward, but Always Wanna Fly really makes them work for it, and this is gonna get the opportunity for Funny mid lane. Starting to get a bit of a push on. Royal to MNT with the units is when he might just find the kill, and he does. Panel Gold was not enough to save the Witch Doctor, but it will pay with his life though. But as we're seeing at this point, Team Spirit just trying to play around the aggression that Finem are going for as a group. And, you know, he manages to get a bit of a sizable force down that mid lane and brings down a Witch Doctor with himself.
Yeah, I think the kill for Finem is more than worth it. Like, Beastmaster is just so much more valuable than a Witch Doctor at this stage in the game. Like, that Witch Doctor is level 8 and just has Arcane Boots pretty much to his name. Not really the highest net worth target by any means, but again, a kill is a kill, I suppose, and he was sitting pretty much right outside of Finem's
space. It was kind of deep.
Yeah, it's not as if Finem can really do anything, you know, anyway, because there's no Roshan up right now. The Chen is making his way towards a mech now after having finished the Aghanims, and to be fair, this Chen is still fairly farmed, you know, 22 minutes in, almost has mech and Aghanims. That ain't too shabby. They got two outer two towers remaining to go for. And then after that, you know, maybe try to get the next Roshan and go for a fight. But the issue with their team, actually, and why the Roshan is even more important for them, as we're going to see Illidan kind of roaming around here for the moment, is they need to Exorcism Rosh to kill it, or it's going to be mega slow. Like,
yeah,
the Chen creeps
that, just the
are
going to
tank it. Like, yeah. Your Ember doesn't even have Battle Fury yet, and it's like 23 minutes in.
Oh, they just AC'd him. They've dropped this sentry. If Illidan comes around, they know they're gonna see him with this observer on the high ground as well, and they know he's dead. He's gonna walk straight into this. They ravage. They're not messing around, but do they have the follow-up damage? Illidan, he just continues to walk in, and with a roar, part of the Stormhammer as well. The Clutch Strike, they found what Static Stoke is laid down by Illidan with the BKB, with the Constrict moving forward, sending Advin and back. Zumbabik sent back glimpse onto those, bring them back into the middle of this fight. He'll yules himself up. Skylark jumping in as well, but Illidan continues to do what he can with the Gold Strike Stormhammer onto Thug, trying to find this Death Prophet kill. Can he do it? Yes, he can. Takes down on the death rocket, three dead on the side of Finem. Madara manages to get himself out of the fight there with the Remnant. There's going to be a Sunstrike. It is off point, but we'll be able to juke it out. But again, these team fights, Team Spirit just playing that little bit better here in game two, and it's really hurting Finem. They don't know how to deal with it. You saw them ravage the Sven and be like, all right, we've seen him, we've caught him, but now what do we do? We've ravaged him, how do we kill him?
Yeah, there was actually no way they had the damage for that, unfortunately. They are going to be able to force Team Spirit back, but I don't think they can actually pursue. Yeah, he's even going to get netted by the summoner there.
Get netted, mate.
But this is kind of that stage in the game where, as Finem, you already wanted to have gotten a set of racks, maybe even two.
You don't, yeah.
If everything is going according to plan. This is not a late game oriented lineup, especially when your Death Prophet died twice in the laning phase. You know, Thug's doing what he can, but he's still pretty much playing a recovery game. And if you compare his farm to the Invokers, it's not really close. So at this stage, maybe taking a long, drawn-out fight, kiting around the Sven is your best bet, but it's kind of tough. You know, you're playing against Disruptor, Beastmaster, these heroes that can pull you out of position, catch you out really easily. We talked extensively about the vision game, Roshan's being done here by Team Spirit, and with no ultimates available on that.
They can't really do anything. I mean, the smoke, so they're moving in.
They have no Ravage, no Exorcism. This fight is, like, super hard for them to take.
Yeah, they're just gonna let it go. And it will indeed. Team Spirit take the Roshan. They get themselves the Aegis once again onto Iceberg. And things are going from just kind of better to better for the side of Spirit. As you said, Invoker looking very, very good in terms of his game at the moment. 14.6k and no signs of slowing down and no signs of Appen being able to stop him. And as we saw in that last fight, they just don't have the means to kill this Sven. I mean, they're relying on the Ember to get his farm. He only managed to get the Battle Fury just about a couple of minutes ago, about 23 minutes in, which is going to be kind of nice for dealing with the high ground push from Team Spirit, but it's just a Battle Fury. He hasn't got anything to follow up in it with the damage on top of that, and it's getting to the point where they just can't fight through this Sven and his armor.
Well, it wasn't already bad enough. There's also a Blink on Illidan too. Like, the last fight, he just had BKB, which is already kind of tough to deal with, but now, because he can actually jump in on his own accord, he doesn't have to have anyone set up for him, it makes it even more threatening, because there is no lockdown for him through BKB. No stuns. So, now he's going to BKB, jump in. If anybody gets roared, they're dead. Like, a Chen send back and a heal is not going to be enough, because you're just going to die too quickly. So now, again, it's just Ad Finem waiting for Team Spirit to maybe overextend, try to bait out the God Strength, try to kite the Sven as much as you can, I suppose. But this is something that, you know, Mad was talking about when he was here, is that Ad Finem like to pick lineups that require heavy execution, and this is one of them. Especially when you're playing against Team Spirit's lineup with the late game Sven, because there's no way you're going to win late game against Team Spirit's lineup with what Ad Finem have. It's just way too difficult.
So, I mean, I just don't see how they can kill the Sven.
They can't. They can. They can.
What series of events? I mean, you're never going to be able to stun him long enough to stop him getting out the BKB. He's always going to have that war cry. So all the damage you do through the BKB in terms of, like, the physical, you know, the damage from the DP's ult, this Ember just with the occasional slight of fist spam, war cry is going to be there. It really is a game where the Sven is just completely out of hand and you don't have the lineup to deal with him.
Yeah, but that's why I was speaking to the way that Ad Finem draft, they like to pick teams where they need to execute their game plan very well in order to win. This one is even more execution heavy, I would say, than game one, because I feel like Team Spirit picked kind of a wonky draft in game one, especially the way they laned it too. But this time around, it's Team Spirit with a very solid draft.
Oh. Illidan was just moving in there, seeing if he could get a Blink initiation. But I'm playing a bit safe for now, Finem, just keeping themselves up on the high ground. I mean, as well, Iceberg's just been having a great time going around the map, clicking creeps. He picked up his axe, and now he's got 3k gold on top of that as well.
Just farm everything. That's the game plan. We can keep Ad Finem in the base forever, says Team Spirit. We'll just use Beastmaster Vision as best we can. We know that Ad Finem are not going to have the late game advantage regardless. We're in no rush to finish the game. If we need to, we can wait for another Roshan spawn.
Maybe if this Ember managed to pull a Daedalus and a Rapier out his backside, they'd have a chance, but that's not going to happen.
It's a lot of money. That's like 12k gold.
Yeah, it's looking tough for Ad Finem at this point. It really is. I mean, game one, it got to the point where Ad Finem were in a position where it was like, well, what the Spirit, it feels like they literally can't do anything, and now game two entirely turned on its head. Team Spirit came into this game with a different approach in terms of the draft. It certainly worked out in the gameplay, and just the way that they've performed with these heroes. It's too much for Ad Finem this time and their lineup. They'll try and hold this back here at the moment, but Spirit moving in onto the tier 3. What have they got to stop it? Matter jumps in with the chains. Out from the Ghost.
Nice.
Skylar with a nice Ravage onto 3. Turns onto Iceberg. There comes the Death Ward as well, but he'll walk it off.
It did no damage.
They've got the control, but they just haven't got the deeps.
It did actually no damage because of the war cry.
I think it healed him.
Yeah. Poor Witch Doctor, man. A 60 damage Death Ward at 30 minutes into the game against a Sven with what? With
Death
war cry
Ward.
On
less
his...
of a Death Ward, more of just a minor illness ward.
Yeah. That was pretty sad for a Witch Doctor. Hopefully there's no one out there who likes playing the hero, because that's got to be demoralizing.
Oh, here we go. Illidan, he's getting a bit ballsy now. He just feels he can just walk up to the steps, walk back. He's in no armor at all.
Yeah. But this is a thing that you can take note of at Finem, I think, if you're a team playing against him and you watch like this kind of game, is you know what kind of stuff they like to do. And oftentimes they don't even really have the better late game. It's more just about early game aggression, trying to end it within like 25-30 minutes. You know, game one is another example of that. Their lineup was capable of fighting at a very early stage. This one is no exception. This one's just more of an all-in. It's like, we all-in push you, especially with a safe lane Ember. That's the other problem, because the way that it matches up with Beastmaster and Sven.
So Black, he can't do what Sven can do. He can't just stand there, because they will burst him down. He may have the untouchable, may have the heals, but he may have the armor.
Okay.
It's going to be fine here. The Static Stone controls Madara, allowing the Invoker to walk this one off.
He's actually opting to put more points into Voodoo Restoration than he is Maldict at this point in the game.
Oh, Madara. Look for the chains down to Illidan. Wasn't able to find it. Caught the creeps on the side camp. And they do manage to push Spirit back at least for the time being, but as we said earlier, Spirit will just be like, okay, you don't want us to break the base, we'll just clear up some of the lanes on the map and a few camps as well. What are you going to do about it? You're probably just going to sit in your own base, stay on the high ground. You're not going to be coming out anytime soon. So Team Spirit, they're like, all right, we'll finish the game in 5 minutes if you don't want us to finish it now.
Yeah, exactly. They can delay it as much as they want. There's no rush. Even Funnick is just sitting in the woods right now, looking for a potential pick, doing some dewarding. They are just not giving Ad Finem any breathing room whatsoever. A slow and painful death, it seems, so far for Ad Finem here in game number 2.
I mean, as we said, I think if you look towards what the possibilities are for Ad Finem, it's the Ember Spirit. He has managed to find a Crystallis, but he's got it, as we said.
Oh, he might be dead.
Okay. Well, there's... Ooh.
Close.
Is they really can't afford to lose the Ember now.
I think if Iceberg was faster with that stun, or faster with the Sunstrike, excuse me, he definitely would have died. Because it was like after the second auto attack, I think, that he realized, and he's like, let me just pop my Sunstrike.
Satanic done on Illidan as well now. If you're not killing him before, you're not killing him now.
Yeah, I find it a bit odd, actually, that he decided to go for Satanic, but I suppose it's one of those things where you can actually just walk up to the racks and hit them.
Yeah.
And there is almost no way you'll die before you can pop BKB.
No.
So in that sense, I think it's a really nice choice. But oftentimes when you're this far ahead, you see like Moonshard and stuff like that. We've been seeing a lot less crits lately, as far as I know.
Yeah, indeed. Daedalus doesn't seem to be the item a lot of the times on the Svens. It's all about those stats.
Well, it's about
and
the stats.
Maybe and attack speed.
Okay, Madara. Might have overstayed your welcome.
So at some point, Hanafgot comes out. All right.
He went back in. No, not like this.
What?
The impetus was still in midair, so he went back in and took a chunk load of damage from the auto attack and just died.
He does have buyback available. He's going to use it, but the Ravage coming through for Skylark. He's going to catch up Goblack, but Illidan moving in onto Thug. Now Illidan.
Oh, that's not who you want to be next to.
No, that could be a dieback. Oh, and it is. All right. And just like that, four heroes down on the side of Ad Finem, and it looks like this game may come to an end. It does indeed. GG, well played at the start. Thug, greet this game with a good luck. Unhappy face. Maybe he's a little bit of a prophet, a death prophet. Prophesized the death of his team in this game with that unhappy face. 19-9. Spirit did it. They certainly showed their weaknesses in game one in terms of the drafting and the play style, but here we have in game two what you kind of expect in terms of Illidan's farming, his ability to choose the fights so when he can. He ends the game 3-0-5. And as you said, it's just Goblack's play on the Enchantress, the laning stage. Iceberg on his Invoker, incredible.